You're about to watch a St. James sermon. It's our very great pleasure to provide this resource for you online, no matter who you are or where you are. We hope this one is a particular encouragement. Of course, there's a lot more to church than just the sermon. And so if you're local here in Cape Town and can make it through to us at St. James, it would be wonderful to see you face to face. There's so much more to see and do and share in together when we're all here in the one space. So won't you make that a priority if you've been following us online but think it might be time to come and introduce yourself in person. We look forward to seeing you soon, but for now, enjoy the sermon.
Well, good evening. It's great to be together, isn't it, on this December 4th. It's early, But we're here to celebrate Christmas. And what a wonderful message that Christmas is. We're here to celebrate that the great creator God, the one who created everything you see in front of you, the one who created all of us, he came to earth as a little baby to be born in a manger, to grow up, to save us from our sins. That's what we're here to think about this evening. That's what we're here to celebrate. We're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to sing some songs to you. You're going to sing with us a lot of the time. We're going to hear the story of Christmas told in various different formats. So, without further ado, let's begin the story.
Tick tock, tick tock, tick tock. The tricky clock tick tocking, each painfully long minute unlocking. The tumbly jumbly can't close your eyes feeling. What will it be? When will it be? Oh, the anticipation, the watching, the wishing and waiting, to let the wiggles and giggles and goosebumps go, to find, to see, to finally know. What will it be? When will it be? Oh, the expectation, the what-ifs, the oh-mys fairly shaking, longing for this night's joy all year, that moment of hope so very near. Oh, but would they, could they, imagine a gift so great, a gift that compelled the whole world to wait? When a heavenly Father gave all mankind his Son, the one love. The magic of Christmas is more brilliant, you see, than a bag or a box tucked under a tree. The true love of Christmas really began when holy God became holy. Man.
Joseph, it's time. He's here.
Well, let's stand together and sing Joy to the World.
Sounding joy, reaping the sounding joy, reaping, reaping the sounding. But there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, and on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
Woof, woof. Bark, 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 bark. Woof, woof. Growl.
There he is. Oh, he's a good dog. He's a good
boy. Stop that. I told you I don't like it when you rub my tummy. It makes my legs shake like that. Right, shepherd man, I've done the rounds. The sheep are asleep. There are no wolves in sheep's clothing. All is safe out there.
Oh, I'm sorry, G-Dog. It's just, I mean, look at you go. You're the best sheepdog a shepherd could ask for. As for this shepherd, I really don't know if I'm cut out for this job.
Why not?
Well, I'll tell you the problem. It's that farmer. He says he's going to fire me. I kind of get where he's coming from, though. Every time I start counting sheep, I fall asleep. I really think it's time to start looking for a new job.
Say woof, a new job? What did you have in mind?
Well, now that you mention it, I was actually thinking I would do something in IT. Yeah. You know, because those computers, they're always looking for extra RAM.
Oh. Hallelujah.
Ta-da-da, ta-da!
G-Dog, what is that thing?
I'm no expert, but I think that's an angel.
Quick, hide!
No, wait. Don't be afraid, but rather be cheerful. I bring good news for all of the people.
If you're a messenger of God, then of course I'm afraid.
Don't.
I'm not ready to meet God yet. No. That would mean I'm dead.
I know.
Why would I?
No, wait. That's what I'm trying to explain. I know you're not ready, and all of these people feel the same. But the good news I bring concerns the town of King David. Today, the Christ was born there. The Lord has come to save us.
Say, woof! God's King has come to save us here on earth? It can't be anywhere around here. This place is a dump.
Well, he is closer than you think, and this will sound even stranger. But if you go down that hill, you'll find a baby in a manger.
What? A baby in a manger? What if the animals eat it?
No, no, silly shepherd. He is a king not like any other. You can search all around the world, and you'll never find another like him.
What is he?
Where did he go? Shepherd man, God has made known to us the birth of a savior. It's time for a mission.
I think you're right again, G-Dog. off to Bethlehem.
Woof, woof, bark, 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 bark.
Well, that was a bit of fun, wasn't it? But just a few days before Jesus was born, let's just reflect on that for a moment. There was a young woman, Mary, who had God inside of her. Imagine how that must have felt. She was cast out, obviously, because she was pregnant before she was married, and she got married quickly, so she wasn't disgraced. She must have felt really like anxious about how people were feeling about her. She was anxious about the birth. She was young. But maybe she was dwelling on this amazing question. Did she know what was growing inside of her? This next song really speaks to that amazing truth.
Stop! know? Did you know what was inside of you? Mary, did you know? I know it caused great hurt and isolation. Say, Mary, did you?
Mary, did you know? No, they put you away and casted you.
Thanks very much, guys. That was Cleo and Jason, two of our members here at St. James. We're going to take a short break right now. If you're new to St. James, a massive welcome to you this evening. It's great to have you here. You're going to hear a lot about the person of Jesus tonight. So if you want to find out more at the end of tonight, please come and speak to me or to Mervyn, who will give the sermon later. And we'd love to tell you more about how to find out about the person of Jesus Christ. But for now, we're going to have a quick break. We're going to take up the collection. If you are new or just visiting, please don't feel obligated to give. It's really for our regulars, but if you want to pop something in the bag, then that would be fantastic. It all goes to the work here at St. James of spreading the gospel in Cape Town. Chat to the people next to you, find out what they're doing for Christmas. Okay, let's come back together. Hopefully you've just made some new friends. Just a couple of quick notices. If you do have little ones with you this evening, please feel free if they get restless. Let them run around. Let them make noise. We're perfectly comfortable. We love little ones here at St. James. We have a big children's church on a Sunday. Please think about coming to join us on a Sunday as well. But please feel relaxed tonight about your little ones enjoying themselves. Also, to tell you that the market is carrying on after the service. So if you didn't quite buy enough cookies, enough sugar, you can get more. And there's lots of other goods for your Christmas presents this year. Also, just to say, please keep an eye on your valuables. We don't want anyone coming to do some early Christmas shopping. So just make sure your phones and bags are in a safe place. Okay, let's carry on with the message of Christmas.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which happened just as they had been told.
Guys, they were telling the truth. The angel was telling the truth. We just went to Bethlehem to check it out, and they were all there. The dad, his name is Joseph, and the mom too, her name's Mary. Oh, and their baby, oh, he's so cute. They were all there just as he said.
Woof, 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 woof. Well, I'll be a dog's uncle. That baby in there is meant to save us. What will he save us from?
I don't know.
Maybe he'll fix the government. They say that King Herod is barking mad.
G-Dog, I think you've done it again. Maybe he can get rid of the Romans. Mm. That Caesar Augustus, he's always rounding people up and counting them and doing nothing about load shedding. It's such a pain.
Maybe he'll make it easier for us to live down here and more affordable. They say the economy has gone to the dogs.
Mary and the baby are sleeping.
Joseph, we're so sorry. We didn't mean to wake them. It's just when the angel told us that the king had been born, we just had to come and check it out.
An angel?
Yeah.
Ah, 9 months ago, an angel came to me too. He told me I must marry Mary. He also gave me the name that we were to call the baby.
Oh, there I go again, forgetting things. I'm so sorry, Joseph. In all the excitement, I forgot to ask. What is the baby's name?
He said the baby was to be named Jesus.
Say woof! Jesus? Why Jesus?
He was to be named Jesus because he was going to save his people from their sin.
Sheep, G-Dog, what does that mean?
Oh, Shepherd, we have a big problem on our hands.
Oh, my word.
Bigger than the government.
Oh.
Bigger than the Romans.
Oh.
Bigger than the economy. But you know what? This baby Jesus, he's the answer.
Oh, okay, let's go check him out again.
Well, we're going to sing one more song to you now, and then it's over to you for the rest of the evening. All of the rest of the carols are congregational after this one. But we're going to feature Hadassah and also the kids. The kids have been working really hard for this evening. They've already done one service this morning, so they're very tired. So let's just give them a round of applause and encouragement now.
Forever, my.
As I said, over to you. Let's stand and sing, O come Emmanuel.
Thank you.
So what now, sheepdog? We've been told about Jesus. We've even seen it with our own eyes. It can't just be back to the sheep for us.
Oh, no, 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 no. I told you, I checked on the sheep before we left, and all 100 of them have been accounted for.
But G-Dog, yeah. Last time I was counting, I fell asleep at 97.
Oh, I told you not to worry. I've rounded them up.
G-Dog, we've been told this special news. Mm-hmm. This can't be the end of the story for us.
I'm sorry. I couldn't help but overhear. You said that you got given some special news.
Oh, it's not just special. It's downright amazing.
That's right, that's right. God has made an announcement. The angel has confirmed it. He has sent his king to earth.
God sent his king to earth? Are we all about to get into trouble?
No, 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 no. That's what I thought, but the angel assured me. It's just the opposite. God's king is his gift to us. It's a reason to celebrate.
Did you guys say celebrate and something about a gift? Can I have a gift too?
Yes, 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 you can. The good news is for all the people. Everyone's invited, even you. But here's something you need to know. The gift is not a thing. It's a person. God has sent his king to save the world.
Save the world? How's that possible?
Well, I'll tell you, strange man. Oh, he's coming on stage. This king is a king like no other. Jesus has come to save his people from their sins. Isn't it the best news you've ever heard? That even though we don't deserve it, God has made a way for us to come back to him.
A way to find peace with God? Now that's news worth listening to. Yeah. And what's the name of the child that'll do all this?
His name is Jesus.
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 Together now, Jesus!
Well, we've been learning a song the last few weeks. It's called Holy Forever. If you are visiting us tonight, see if you can join in. It's quite a simple song, but everyone else, it's your turn to shine. Let's sing.
Song of
Let's take.
Well, good evening, dear friends. And before I do anything else, let's just give this team here behind me another expression of our appreciation. They've been working flat out. The neighbors have heard it a lot. And if you're one of the neighbors, thanks for being here tonight. If you're just new to us, thank you for coming. And if you're part of our regular church family, it's just lovely to have you back with us again on a Sunday evening. It's been a while since we've been together on Sunday evenings. You know that when you hit carol services that Christmas is on the agenda, right? Once the carol services start, you know the countdown has begun. And as we were reminded, that little video clip we saw right at the beginning, Christmas is a time for traditions, for excitement, especially if, like some of those little people, you haven't got all your teeth yet. It's just a wonderful, wonderful time of the year, and we're so grateful for it. And we all, of course, have many different traditions as part of our Christmas, just the things we do, the time we put the tree up, when we have our meals, whatever it happens to be. And whatever your Christmas tradition happens to be, we want to say that our prayer for you is that it will be a rich and a meaningful time for you. If you're traveling, you'll be in our prayers for safety on the roads. I guess because we want Christmas to be a rich and a meaningful time for you, we want to turn our attention now away from traditions, away from the gifts that we give or receive, and we want to turn our attention to the Word of God, which, unlike our traditions, is utterly reliable, and away from ourselves and onto God, who really is and must be the focus of every single Christmas. And so tonight, as we think about God as the giver of gifts and the greatest gift of all, and really throughout this Advent period, right through Christmas and on into the new year, and I'd like to invite you to come and join us again Sunday by Sunday as we work our way through this little series about God and about His gift to the world. We want to spend our time focusing on what we've heard already, the greatest gift of all. And so tonight, what I want to do is I want us to look at three verses, and I want us to take away with us three lessons, and really to respond to these lessons. The verses will come up on the screen, hopefully, technology permitting. There they are. And what I'm going to get us to do is we're going to read each one as it comes up, just to make sure you stay awake. And I'm going to say a few things about each one. So here we go. Let's read James chapter 1, verse 17 together. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. What an extraordinary statement. So here's the very first lesson. God is the true and the trustworthy gift giver. Just look at that verse again and see what it teaches us about God. It describes God there as the Father of the heavenly lights. What does that mean? Well, it's another way of speaking about God as the Creator. When you have an opportunity, walk out on a dark night, as I did growing up on a farm in the Free State, no lights anywhere, Eskom didn't matter because we had a generator, a big old diesel Lister, and diesel wasn't nearly as expensive as it is today. And when the generator was shut down and everything was in darkness, if you stepped outside the door and looked up at the sky, and you will have done this yourself, you just see these amazing stars. I see my Sutu sister understands. Absolutely, the Free State and the stars, what a wonderful place. And God is the creator of each and every one of them. Space in all its enormity, the stars, the sun, the moon, the heavenly lights, as Genesis calls them. We are reminded that God is the creator of everything, and that as creator, he holds everything in his hands. The Father of the heavenly lights means that God hung all those stars in space. Not one of them is lost. He names them. He controls them. God is the creator of the world. And if he can rule the stars, dear friends, then there's nothing on the face of this earth that is beyond his control. And right at the end of our verse, we're told that God is utterly reliable. I love that phrase. He does not change like shifting shadows. If, back in the Free State again, if you walked out in a hot day, and you'd always have a shadow, right? Your shadow would be there. And as the sun moves, so your shadow moves. And we've seen that all over. Shadows move as the suns move. And God is not like that. He's not, if you like, a shifty God. The gods of the pagan world, the gods of religion, are untrustworthy. If you know your mythology, if you know the stories of the ancient gods of the world, the Greek gods, the Roman gods, you'd know that they could never be trusted. You would do as much as you could. You'd pay all the bribes you could. You'd do all the ablutions you could. And you'd bring all the gifts that you could. And they would still change their mind. And some people think that God of the Bible is like that. And this verse tells us he's absolutely not like that. We break promises, right? We mean... Whoop-a. Hang on a second. And a bit. No. Yes. Well, if you were snoozing... Nou is jy wakker. What was I saying? We make promises. We have plans. We have schemes. We mean well, and yet we can't live up to what we say. We are like the shifting shadows, right? It's not always our fault. God is never like that, dear friends. He is utterly unlike us. What an amazing God he is. But above all, this verse tells us that this God, the creator of the world, the ruler of the world, the one who is trustworthy and true, is the giver of good and perfect gifts. Every good thing in this world ultimately has God as its source. It may come to us through different means, but behind it is the kindness and the big-heartedness of God. Every good thing in this world comes from God. Every good thing in your life is a gift from God. That's what our verse tells us, right? Every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights. Every kindness, every good thing in this world comes because God is good and God is kind and God is big-hearted. I wonder if you think about God like that. I wonder if your view of God is that he's a miser. I wonder if your view of God is that he's a taker. Maybe you've lost something in the last few years. Maybe you've suffered great difficulties and trials, and you find yourself deep down in your heart, and you find yourself actually blaming God for that. You say, it's your fault. Well, if you feel like that about God, can I ask you a favor? Tell him, won't you? He's big enough to take it. You can tell him to his face what he thinks, what you think. But let me assure you that through all the brokenness and all the despair and all the despondency and all the pain and all the hurt, there is a God who loves you and who gives and does not take. God is not a sponger. He's not a taker. God is a giver. So let me ask you, is that how you think about God? Do you see him that way? I hope that by the time you leave here tonight, you'll at least start thinking about God in a different way if you see him as someone untrustworthy and a taker rather than a giver. May God grant that just through what we've seen now, your view of God will change, or at least that you'll say to yourself, if you haven't yet done so, God, please help me to see you as you really are, not as I assume you to be because of the things that might have happened in my life. Here's verse number 2. It's a very famous verse. And lesson number 2, John 3:16. Let's say it together. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Alison was here this morning. She said, when you read the verse, read it slowly. Sorry. Have a look at it again. What do you observe? it's an extraordinary verse. It's a famous verse. There are 4 things for us to see here. Number 1, God's Son, Jesus, is his gift to the world. That's what we've been reminded of by G-Dog and the shepherd and everyone else. Gareth, you're never going to live that down, brother. Never mind executive pastor. From now on, I baptize you G-Dog, and G-Dog you will be. That's what we've been reminded of, right? Today, right up here in our presentation, that the greatest gift of all is God's gift of his own Son. And he has a name, and his name is Jesus. And notice there that God's gift of his Son is motivated by his love. God gave his Son to the world because he loves the world. And you know what the astonishing thing about that is? We hardly love him back, right? In John's Gospel, from where that verse comes, we are told right at the beginning that he came to his own, but his own did not acknowledge him. Though the world was made through him, the world did not receive him. How do you respond when you are rejected? How do you respond, dear friend, when people whom you have been kind to or good to or who ought to love you don't love you back? But God's love, you see, is not conditional. The astonishing thing about God's love is that he shows it to those of us who don't deserve his love. That's the amazing thing, that God loves those who don't love him, and that he loves us in this way, that he took what was most precious to him, his own Son, and because of his love, he gave him for you and for you and for all of us. What an extraordinary gift. All the gifts in the world put together, all the gifts in the world down the ages added up, can never, ever, ever compare with that gift. And notice in this verse that God's gift of his Son was for eternal benefit. God gave his Son so that you and I might not fall prey to the worst of all the things. No, it's not ESCOM. No, it's not the government. No, it's not the buffalo and the dollars in the couch. No, it's none of those things. The greatest problem that you and I have, dear friends, is the problem of eternal death. The Bible says it's appointed for us once to die, and die we will, and then to face the judgment. Jesus himself reminded us that the one that we should fear is not the one who can take away our lives, but the one who, once our lives have been taken away, has the power to destroy our souls in hell. It's not a great thing to say at Christmas time. It is the most important thing to say at Christmas time. God gave his Son so that you and I do not have to go down that path. God loves you enough to send his Son to take your place, because Christmas and Easter are tied together, right? The Son who came to die so that you and I might not perish, but have eternal life. What an extraordinary gift. And it calls for a response, right? And John tells us what that response is. To believe in him. That is, to believe the truth about him. And then, having believed that truth about him, to put your trust in him. Do you see Jesus this way? As God's great gift to the world. As God's gift for you. And will you trust him? Do you trust him? Do you trust him with your life and with your eternity? Do you trust him? If not, will you trust him today? Verse number 3, lesson number 3. John 4:10. This is Jesus' answer to the woman of Samaria. Jesus had gone to the well in Samaria. He'd gone where no Jewish man would go. He spoke to a woman there in the middle of the day. She was a dodgy person, just like us. She had a dodgy background. And Jesus took the trouble to find her and to talk to her. And in the middle of the conversation, as he began the conversation and gave her this answer, let's read it. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." Here's the extraordinary thing. that Jesus, who is the gift of God, that Jesus, who came into this world and humbled himself and took on our human weakness, even to the point of thirst and ultimately death itself, that Jesus, who is the gift of God, is also the giver of God's gift. Can you see that? And how is the gift that he gives described? Well, in John 3, it's described as eternal life. Here in John 4, it has this wonderful metaphor of living water. What Jesus has to offer you, dear friend, will quench the thirst of your deepest, innermost soul. What Jesus has to offer you will satisfy you forever. Even in the face of the desert of death, the living water of Jesus will continue. It will refresh you. It will revive you. It will keep you even in the darkest of days. Where I come from, it's pretty dry. What a wonderful thing it is when you find a spring. Not just a pool of water which dries up, but a spring, a well, where the water keeps welling up. That is the gift of Jesus to you. He died for you. He rose again. And if you will trust him, he puts his Holy Spirit in you, and you will find life, life, satisfaction, your thirst, that emptiness in you, that dryness that dogs your steps, sorry, G-Dog, that drugs your steps all the way, that very dryness will be taken away. For who? For those who ask. God is the giver of great gifts. The greatest gift in the world is the gift of his Son. And that Son, if you trust him, will give you what you desperately need. And if you already trust him, do you know what you'll discover? That every day he will give you what you need. Day in and day out, Jesus is enough. So will you ask? And will you keep asking? Jesus promises, whoever asks will receive. Jesus promises that if you come to him, no matter who you are, no matter what your background is, no matter how much you've messed up in your life, if you come to him, no matter how young you are, no matter how old you are, if you come to him, he will never send you away dry and empty. So will you ask? Let me pray for us. Lord, we thank you for these wonderful things. And tonight, as we've heard your word sung, as we've heard it spoken about, and as we've heard it explained, we pray that you, by your Spirit, would help that word to take root today in our hearts, so that we too may drink of that living water. We pray this for your glory and for our eternal good. Amen. We're going to sing again.
Well, guys, thank you so much for coming this evening. We really hope you've enjoyed it. We've got so many services coming over the next few weeks. Come back and join us. I think there's a flyer in the foyer you can pick up with a list of everything that's happening here at St. James. But let me close in prayer before we head out and enjoy the market outside. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for Christmas. Thank you for this wonderful message that we've just heard, that Jesus came as a baby to save us from our sins. Help us to respond rightly this Christmas and accept him as our Lord and Savior. Amen. See you soon.